entire think tank about this. When you build a technology, what are you building for? What does it look like? What should it look like? And we're thinking about autonomous systems. People are very concerned that their jobs will be taken away by robots. Well, perhaps that it may be the case because of the repetitive jobs, but there may be, Joyce just inspired us, new opportunities to learn something else. Now, one thing that you must be cognizant of is if we can call this lifelong learning, which it is lifelong learning. So you are going to be, to some extent, responsible for your own careers in this space. There's also another component of this, which is the models, the values. And if you were to actually summarize what's being stated here, what we're looking at is open and transparency. From closed to open and transparent, where an employer, an employee, are actually not, employee is not just a tool anymore. There is this co-creative relationship as well as what it is with our customers and ecosystem of people. Open and transparent is very, very important. And it is the philosophy, if you will, if we think about blockchain, that is the philosophy. Very, very transparent. So open, open source, everything is open. And that becomes very, very interesting in its own case. And by the way, one thing I will say is how many of you are familiar with something called Game Changer 500 Index? Look it up. Look up Game Changer 500 Index. See if your companies or your organizations or your countries are in that Game Changer 500 Index. The CEO is a millennial. His name is Andrew Hewitt. And what he's looking at is exactly this. Going to open, going to transparency. How do enterprises treat its employees, et cetera, et cetera. Millennials care about the fact that this is not made out of child labor. There's something called purposeful. There's something that you deal with in terms of a purpose. And what he's saying is social responsibility for a profit is huge. 92% of consumers will switch to a brand if they know you are responsible for it. That's a really important thing to know. This is my geek chart. I love this chart. Because that's where I stand, up here. If you look at all these technologies that are shaping the future, if you're scientists, how many of you are medical scientists in the room? Great. If you're a scientist, what you're doing in the space of medical research, what are you doing, for example, when we're looking at the issue of infrastructure or ICT research, which is as a service or cybersecurity? Do not underestimate, when we're looking at the Internet of Things, the importance of end-to-end, thing-to-thing security. Events of last week in the United States will actually prove that out. And by the way, we are walking, pulsating information about ourselves. How many of you are wearing smartwatches? How many of you use these? So you see, you're pulsating things about yourself. And with that goes responsibility and privacy. I don't think we understand really well what privacy is all about. We have a chief privacy officer in our company, and what she's doing is this intersectionality between law and also what it is you're doing in terms of developing product. Privacy by design, privacy engineering, etc. I think this is very, very key. So we have Internet of Things, we've got cloud computing, we have drones. And, oh, by the way, mixed reality. I'm a co-chair in a mixed reality group, which is a group looking at, of an overall committee, a group looking at building ethics into autonomous systems. And why is that? If you think about mixed reality, it's experiential. I can experience you as a immigrant. You can experience me as perhaps a technologist. I can experience you as something. And it's experiential. It's also used for treatment of people who have been traumatized. But there is also a notion of responsibility that we have to care about when we're looking at these systems. We have to allow for randomness and serendipity. We have to allow for that because it can be abused. And that's why a group of us in the industry are coming together and asking questions. Are we asking the right question? Do robots have rights? What can we do from a legal perspective? How are we going to keep up, or how are governments going to keep up with all of this change? So it's now, it's not in the future, it's happening now, these sets of discussions. What about health? What about 3D scaffolds? Or really smart pills? Proteus pill was FDA approved several years ago. It exists today. A lot of what I'm talking about exists today. What about the notion of collaborative industrial robots, where I, as a human being, am working side to side with a robot in a manufacturing firm? ABB does that today. So you see, a lot of this stuff, technologies, are today shaping the future and will continue to do so. And you have the opportunity, as extraordinary, particularly extraordinary women, to set your footprint there, and to set your footprint in a very bold way. So when we look at some of the impacts of these industries, impacts that are felt today, we have a lot of global economic scenarios that are happening. We are looking, especially when we see the impact from today, climate change, huge subject as we know it. We have been talking about it. Young demographics in terms of emerging markets, lots and lots of countries with people, 50% of their population under the age of 24, has a huge amount of impact to jobs and to learning. If I look also to 2015, 2017, we're now looking at this notion of, oh, by the way, women. And also longevity and ageism. Let me pause for a moment. Ladies and gentlemen, we're living longer. 65 years old is from von Bismarck. That means you don't have to retire if you don't want to at age 65. I'm working with a lady who is very, very revolutionary in this space. Her name is Elizabeth Eisel. She's in her mid-70s. And she wants to remove the word retire from our language. It is shameful that in Silicon Valley, you're over the hill at age 20. Shameful, because the new 21st century requirement is all about multi-generational teaming. Working together in multi or intergenerational teams. Fantastic, how great is that? And if we move, and it's exponential, quote unquote. You know, that's an interesting mathematics there. Now you're looking at genomics. Now you're looking at what does that really mean in terms of sciences? What about this whole notion of AI? And by the way, from an AI perspective, what I'm looking at, AI plus blockchain, I'm looking at how could we use the technology to create people-neutral systems, what I call PNs. In an enterprise where it's not just about unconscious bias trading, but also I gamify it. You opt in, token in, you get paid a token, a token, a token. And at the end, you amass so many tokens that maybe that is your new bonus, a social responsibility kind of bonus. And reward the behavior for which we desire. Should you be reading your mails over the weekend? Maybe you want to. How connected do you want to be? So this is really interesting in terms of the environments that we're talking about and the world that we're in and where we're going from an education perspective and from an industry perspective. Blockchain, how many of you are into blockchain? Well, you know what? It's nascent and we should all understand it. It's not just the fintech or financial technology environment, but it is like it is when we were looking at the internet probably 30 years ago. So it's not a fully baked notion of this public hyperledger system, but from an IT perspective, from your company perspective, or from your research perspective, where do you see that going? Are you prepared as an enterprise? What does that mean in terms of alternatives to smart, to looking at smart contracts and what that could be, or asset tracking? What are the alternatives there? The interesting thing about blockchain, which is very disruptive, is that it is very open, and it is based on trust. You trust that open. You trust something is going to, you see it. It's this distributed trust system. You may not know who's at the other end, or who's involved, or what is involved. But from a technology, from the technologists in the room, we have lots of problems that we have to solve here. We have scaling issues. We have storage issues. We have cryptography issues that we have to take a look at. And people will say, what about the bad players? Well, you know, every technology has bad players. I think this is something that we have to take a look at. But in the end, there are corporations, there are companies already looking into this space. I'll give you an example. I have some people within my own corporation looking at it in terms of creating what we call, especially, and now they don't call it human resources anymore, I used to call it human remains. I was really, really bad about that. But they're calling it business intelligence. And I'm going to create a reputation system. And I create a reputation system about how you all work. And I base it on something called a talent cloud. And oh, by the way, that becomes very interesting. Now, my counter-argument is you don't have some central governance in model in the middle. But companies are doing it, including our company today. So very, or at least exploring it. So blockchain, and one country you should look at, Estonia, already there. Already there. So very, very interesting. Are you going to be ready for this? What about drones? How many of you care about drones? I know Joyce is going to care about drones. I know you do. But if you think about what's happening with drones, it's really interesting, especially about what you do with agriculture. What does that mean in terms of holding the information that is actually being captured? What kinds of distributed computing do you need to have in this space? And oh, by the way, Chinese company coming out with a passenger